pure experiences.
Today's topic is the origin of the mind. So we have seen that our experience consists of four kinds of categories. We can divide our experience into four categories. That's how we started. I'll just give you a summary. These categories are the world, the mind, the body, and the consciousness. This is how we started the meetings. So our experience is four kinds: the world, the body, the mind, and the consciousness. And then in the next meeting, I simply changed my tune and I said, consciousness is not an experience, it is the experiencer. So then we are left with only three things, which are the world, the body, and the mind. These are the experiences. And at least in my own experience, my own observation, I've never seen anything else than these three. Now you can go ahead and put the body and the world in one category, which is the experience of physical objects, because body is physical. It is a subject matter of senses. So the body is seen through the senses, can be perceived through the senses, just like any other object. However, it has a subjective part. The body has a subjective part which cannot be perceived through the senses, but it is perceived directly by the mind. So body is a kind of special thing, but we can put the body into at least the physical part of the body into world. So we are left with only two kinds, which is the physical and the non-physical. Non-physical being the mental experiences, the subjective experiences. So what are those physical and non-physical? Physical are all the different sense perceptions, usually. Depending on the senses, they can be colors and shapes or sounds, tones, and can be smells, touch, etc. And the mental experiences or perceptions are of thoughts, imaginations, memories, and emotions, and feelings, and so on, bodily sensations. So whatever that is coming through the senses is seen as physical. Whatever that is coming through the directly without any sensory intervention is seen as mental. And this is a major division that we can do about our experiences. But if we take a closer look, like we did in the past meetings, we'll find that all the physical experiences can be again reduced back to mental. They can be reduced back to non-physical ones, because all the experiences are subjective. They are happening in the mind. The mind projects them outside and draws an imaginary line between them, between itself and the experience. Usually for the physical part, it is the imaginary line is the body. Whatever is happening outside the body is physical. Whatever is happening inside it is me, and it is non-physical and it is subjective. So we have seen that the division is artificial. We can reduce all the perception, whether physical or non-physical, into one kind, which is mental, the non-physical one. So there is only one kind of experience left. We started with four, and but our observation, our own experience tells us that there is only one kind, and that experience is all mental, all non-physical. So this is what we are going to define as the mind. Whatever is happening, whatever events are taking place in our experience is mind. Now this is a very, very broad definition. You never heard this kind of definition before, that everything, every experience is just mind. So why do I call it as mind? Because this is all we experience, and since all that we can experience is of one kind, it makes sense. It makes, you know, perfect sense to call it, give it a single name, and then divide the kinds of experiences that are going on in the mind as physical, non-physical, or objective, subjective, and different experiences corresponding to different senses, and different experiences corresponding to the internal senses. That means our the pains that are in the body are of a different kind, and the pains and pleasures are, you know, in a different category. Recalls of the memory, they are of different kind. Imaginations are of different kind. Emotions and feelings, they are of different kind. So we don't actually pay attention to whatever is happening inside the mind so much. We just say that it is me, and whatever is happening outside is more important to us in the day-to-day life. This is the condition, this is the situation of an ordinary person. So when I say that everything is mind, usually it is a surprise for many, because we are so much used to calling our memories and thoughts as our mind, and the rest is, you know, just ignored, or the mental things are simply ignored. They are called as me for some reason, I, and the actions that I am doing, and the only reality that is left is the physical one, the objects. So our because of our conditioning, our view is narrowed down so much so that the only experience that we think is important and is actually exists, is of any value, is the experience of the objects, experience of the world. World here, the definition of the world is the collection of objects. World is nothing but a collection of objects. It is, the world is not a globe or a single planet or anything. It is, according to my definition, it is everything that can be, you know, known via the senses. That is the world, external to the senses. Subject matter of senses is the world, and everything that can be known directly is non-physical. So there are two kinds of worlds now, the physical world and the non-physical world. And we can reduce the physical into non-physical, and you will find that there is only one kind. Actually, these divisions are just for convenience. Sometimes we say, when we talk about a specific kind of experience, we say, we name it like this. So all the experiences of the world, the physical kind, I name it as the worldly experiences, the objective things, which are shared between people. This is an amazing thing that those experiences are shared, but the non-physical ones are not shared. That is more correct criteria for dividing up the experiences, you know, shared experiences and unshared experiences. So this is how we arrived at the consensus reality that day when I was talking about that the objective things are shared experiences. We agree about those experiences, although they are subjective. This is what the world is made up of, shared experiences. Anyway, so I'm coming to the topic now, which is how did all this originate? How did the mind originate? How did all this come to be? How it got created? And since that our definition of the mind is, you know, so wide that everything is mind now, including our own personal experience of the mind, which is I'm going to call as the human mind, and the rest is the universal mind. I'm going to use this terminology. So again, one more division for the convenience, for just to talk about it, is the experience of the human mind and the experience of the universal mind. Now, what comes under the category of the universal mind? All the experiences that I don't label as me. If I label some of the experiences I, myself, they are experiences of the human mind. And beyond this boundary, all the experiences, whether physical, non-physical, metaphysical, whatever, they are all experiences of the universal mind. So, how did all this originate? We have seen that whenever there is an experience, there is an experiencer. And whenever there is an experiencer, there is experience. So these two are not different. They are just one. They are one entity appearing as two. And we have seen that the mind is responsible for this division also. And we did not define the mind at that time like this. So can we say that the experience is responsible for dividing the experience into dividing the what is into experience and the experiencer? Now this will become confusing. That's why I used the word mind there, as you know. And I told you that the mind is the human mind. Our ability to, you know, divide, our capability to discriminate is responsible for dividing this. So actually, mind is a part of the experience. So it will be correct to say that since there is an experience, and the experience is coming via the mind, the experience itself is responsible for this division of the experiencer and the experience. Otherwise, there is just one. Now, what makes this division so solid is that the mind has an activity very, very fundamental process that is going on in the experience field. This activity is called memory. So if so memory is responsible for the division of the experience into two. Otherwise there is no division. Otherwise there is just experiencing, and we touched upon this thing before. And you will find that if you pretend that you cannot remember even 1 second of your experience, you will come very, very close to what is. You will come very, very close to how the existence will look like when there is no mind or there is no memory. You can do this exercise in your spare time. Reflect upon this. What happens if there is no memory? The experiences just flow through. In other words, there is just experiencing. There is no division at all. There is nothing there which says that there is an experiencer and there is an experiencer. There is an experience and there is an experiencer. Why? Because nothing sticks. So immediately you can conclude, you know, that memory is something very, very special. And I'm going to say that memory is what forms the essence of the mind. Any mind, the universal mind or the human mind or any other kind of mind. So a mind is nothing but memory. And what is memory? Memory is nothing but a collection of patterns, an impression of patterns. So now you must be getting a hint of how mind is formed, how mind comes into being. Mind is just patterns, but they are stable because they are impressed upon the memory. What is memory? Memory is a structure on which other patterns get impressed, the patterns surrounding it. This is the essence of a mind. And in the last meeting, we have seen that all experiences are just patterns. And memory is one of them. But memory has a special characteristic. It has a very peculiar ability that it can take on the impressions from other patterns and fake the other patterns. It acts as if it is the other pattern. There is a small part of the structure of the memory, and it, you know, takes on the impression just like wet sand. If you press your hand on the wet sand, the sand takes on the impression of the hand. There is a little fake hand there, and the hand won't last because, you know, the structures are always changing. The impressions don't last. But what has happened is the sand, which is a structure, has taken on the impression of another structure, which is the hand. Memory works in the same way. It takes on the impressions from other patterns. And because there are infinite kinds of possibilities, there are infinite kinds of patterns, and the memory is just one of these infinite kinds of structures which has the special ability to mimic the incoming pattern, the pattern that it is in contact with. And this is the essence of the mind. And how does the memory originates? Whenever a pattern can come in contact with, take on an impression from another pattern, the result is a memory. When there is an interaction between the pattern, and one pattern is affected in such a way that the other one leaves an imprint on it, memory is born. And why does that happen? Because there are infinite possibilities, and this possibility is also there. There cannot be any other reason. There is no intention behind it. There is nothing that is creating the memory. There is nothing that is forcing the memory into existence. It is there because everything is there. So as soon as this imprint happens, a memory is formed. And then this is the seed of the mind. Memory is the seed of the mind. Okay, this is my question here. So when I sleep deep and wake up, I do not have a memory of sleep, but I know I experience sleep. What exactly does this imply in this context? This is what I was talking about when if we pretend that there is no memory, I cannot, you know, remember even one split second of my experience, what will happen? It will be like deep sleep, isn't it? It will be like deep sleep, and you will wake up with no memory of what happened, but you will have a faint recall, very, very faint, that something was there before this and now something is here. That means in between something must have happened. This is what we call as experience of the sleep. Actually, we cannot experience the deep sleep. It is always inferred from the past memory and present memory, and whatever happened in between, we name it as the experience of the sleep. Because as soon as we say, no, I experienced the sleep, that means you were not asleep. That means you were awake. So, okay. I think audio is not good for everyone. But this is being recorded, so you can go back and listen to the recording if you missed something. I was saying, the seed of the mind is the memory. As soon as the imprints start forming on a structure, a mind is born. And this mind has nothing else except a very, very basic rudimentary memory. That's all it is. It is taking on the impressions from all that is around it, and then it degrades and dissolves back into whatever there is, you know. It is born out of the sea of randomness, all possibilities, and it dissolves back into all the possibilities. This is the seed mind. This is the seed memory. And how does it get from that, you know, very, very basic and simple thing to this human mind, which is, you know, extraordinary, which is giant, you know, a marvelous thing, a complicated thing? How does it happen? that simple thing, which is, you know, hardly distinguishable from anything in the existence around it, becomes such a big structure, such an advanced, evolved structure. How does it happen? So you will find that there are not only patterns, there are processes. A process is nothing but a changing pattern. If a pattern changes in a regular way, you know, you can predict how it is going to change, what will be the next pattern and all. We call it as a process. Now you must have never heard this definition before again. These things are, you know, never taught in schools or colleges, or they are not even taught in very, very, you know, big universities or higher educations. Now the you can substitute the words, you know, the word is just language, but you can use any word for it. But these things are seen by a gyani, by a yogi. When you reflect on your experiences, you will see all these things. These things cannot be taught. You will see what is a pattern, you will see what is a process. When you clean up your mind, your conditioning, you'll be left with only these things. You can call it anything, you know. I chose the name of process. So whenever there is a memory, you know, processes start forming around it. Don't worry, I'm going to repeat everything again and again and again in many, many meetings. So you are missing nothing actually. So if you cannot understand anything, just ask me, what did I say? And I was saying that whenever there is this basic pattern, processes start forming around it. In the same way, you know, the pattern of memory organizes itself, the processes organize itself. So we have, you know, introduced the process. I don't think I've introduced the process. So a process is something which repeats endlessly, which starts and does the same thing again and again and again. The pattern repeats in the same way again and again and again. So what are the practical examples of the processes? Process of organizing things, which is the self-organizing process. Process of copying things, which is the self-replicating process. And there are many, many processes that are happening. And the most basic process is vibration. The process of change of one state into another state. This is the binary vibration. That is the most basic process. There cannot be a process simpler than this one. So what it does is it changes from one state to another, then again to the next state and to another, you know, very, very simple thing. But these processes can combine together and form complex processes. So let us say there is a process running alongside the memory, which copies the memory. Suddenly we have a copy of the mind, the basic mind. This is the basic reproduction. This is what has evolved into this thing, you see. The whole game of creatures and lives. Very simple. Very simple process. It has evolved into something complex. So, let us say there is another process which copies the contents of the memory and plays it back. You know, that will be a process of recall. Let us say there is another process which mixes two contents in some way. This is the process of imagination, you know. Take two things from the memory, mix them, you have imagined something new. So on and on and on, you know, there are a number of processes that start forming around this mind, and this mind evolves. This mind gets bigger and bigger and more complicated, and more memories are put into it. Now, I said that there is a tendency for everything to dissolve back, you know, because these are experiences. Experiences are made up of change that we saw in the last meeting. Change means experience, experience means change. And whenever there is a change, things are not going to last. They dissolve, they change into something else. And so all this, you know, drama that is happening, which I'm calling it as mind, changes because of the very nature of the experience, you know, it is going to change. Whatever exists is changing. So there is a process there, which, you know, pops up, which keeps the mind going, you know, which resists the change, which resists the dissolution of the mind back into randomness. This is our basic self-preservation process. So why does this process, you know, attach with the mind? Let us imagine, you know, 100 minds where there is no self-preservation process running, and 100 minds where it is running nicely. So if you come back after 1 year, you'll find that, you know, from the first group, only a few minds have left because of chance. But the second group is flourishing. It is copying, reproducing, and, you know, the population has increased. So this is a natural happening. This is a natural happening. If something preserves itself, it sustains itself. It continues. Something does not preserve, preserves. It is on the mercy of change. It is on mercy of impermanence, and it, you know, fades away into something else. This is what happens, you see. It is not a theory. You can actually see all whatever I'm saying. You can see it around you, actually. It is derived from our direct observation of our experience. So whatever we do not preserve, we do not maintain, fades away, you know, becomes something else. This is also called, in physics, it is also called the law of entropy. You know, entropy always increases. There is only one thing where the entropy decreases, which is life, the biological life. But you'll find that it, you know, decreases for a while, then it starts increasing again, and the life also fades away. So everything is impermanent, there is no question about it. But there are some processes which, you know, try to keep the structure going for a while. They fail eventually, but the structure will last for a long time because of this process. At least it will last till it copies itself. And then in the processes, they don't care. When the copy is made, you know, the processes, if they fade away, doesn't matter, because the continuation has been achieved. And you will find the same tendency in the life forms, actually. Whatever is the basic, you know, whatever happened during the origin of the mind is still here. It has not gone away. Human body, if you take an example of a process, has evolved to take, you know, be healthy and fit till the age of reproduction. As soon as the reproduction has happened, you know, the replication has happened, the processes don't care, you know, the body starts falling. So same principle applies at the when you consider the origin of the mind from metaphysical patterns. Now, what is metaphysical pattern? It is just change, pure change without any substance. Now, is it a, you know, theory or some kind of assumption that there is no substance, there is just change? No, it is direct observation. You can see it. You can see in your mind, thoughts are made up of nothing. There is just change. There is just information there, you know, there is no substance. So what kind of pattern is it, you know? We can call it a non-physical pattern, but then you'll find that the same thing applies to the physical patterns. There is no substance to any of the experience, actually. It is just change. You can confirm it yourself. And so that's why I call them as metaphysical patterns. And where are these patterns happening? Where is this change happening? And we have seen that the change is not really happening. It is a virtual change. The happening and the change is also a product of processes. Now, here, you know, it becomes really, really confusing, because we are touching the boundaries of the mind now, and it is going beyond our ability to understand. So we can perceive all these things, we can experience all these things, but if you ask for a description, it becomes difficult, because a description is of something is in terms of something more fundamental. And if you reach the limit of, you know, fundamental, if you reach the most fundamental thing, you will find that it becomes very difficult to describe it. You will find that you are now describing it in terms of something else, and the something else is being described in terms of the first thing. So it becomes circular. But you can experience this. There is really no change. And whatever appears is the experiencer itself taking these virtual forms, the virtual patterns. The patterns are very, very basic, actually. These processes, they combine the patterns in various ways and, you know, produce the complexity. So we can say that as soon as the mind starts forming and, you know, it starts taking impressions on itself, it becomes very, very systematic. Because of the self-preservation processes, it will not allow anything that changes it too much. If it changes it in a way that keeps it going, okay, then the impressions are allowed in and the memory forms. But the changes are such that they are going to break the mind, they are going to break the memory, they are not allowed. And this is why as soon as the senses are formed, as soon as the body is formed, bodies are formed, you'll find that the window of the changes that the mind can perceive becomes narrower and narrower and narrower. So if you take our experience of the senses, it is very, very narrow. It is only that much which enables our survival. Nothing more than that. We do not perceive even it is very, very limited. Our minds are very, very limited, and the limitation is imposed upon the mind through the senses. and the body. Why? Because that helps in survival. Let us say, if we expose our mind to all kinds of changes, it will dissolve into everything within minutes. It won't stay there. These self-preservation tendencies, the processes in the mind that are preserving the mind, preserving the memory, are very powerful. They are so powerful that they will limit all the experience if it is needed, and allow only that which is not harmful for the mind. And we call that part of the mind which is interested in nothing but the self-preservation. We have a special word for this mind, a very infamous word. It is called ego. E-G-O, ego. So ego is the part of the mind that is, a bundle of processes whose only task, they act in such a way that they enable and preservation of the mind. Yes. So for an egoic person, for any, anything that is interested in just preservation, like animals or insects or anything, all the actions are nothing but egoic. Yes, as the mind ages, self-preservation is always preventing new impressions. This is seen as resistance to learning in older people. They cannot learn a lot only if they are forced, too much. They are ready to take on anything new, or change their habits or change their action. For younger minds, it is not that much, important. The mind knows that, it is on the rise. It is on the rising part of the curve. So it lets in all the impressions. And because, some kind of learning is important for self-preservation, and only that kind of learning passes through the mind. And when we were talking about the advanced topics in the last meetings, like surrender and resistance, you can now relate all those, behaviors of the mind to these self-preservation egoic processes. Resistance is what? Egoic processes. Resisting new knowledge. They don't want mind to change. They want to preserve the memory, you see. These processes are protecting the mind. So they will resist anything that, is contradictory to what exists. You see? It all makes sense now. And when you study the mind, everything makes sense. Everything will fall into place. That's why again and again, you'll find me repeating that the best thing to study in this world is your own mind. Nothing else is worth studying, actually. If you study your mind, you see what it's doing, you will know everything. This is a spiritual path is. This is what a spiritual path is. Study the self. Improve the self. So when we, how to improve, when we'll know the limitations, when we'll know the deficiencies there, when we'll know the abnormal functions, only then it becomes possible to improve it. Otherwise not. How will you know? Does somebody need to tell you? No, we all have minds. We can just watch. Okay. So meanwhile, there was one more question. What is the way to counter such resistance? Yes, the only way to counter the resistance is surrender. And we had a long discussion on the surrender that day. And we are going to repeat it some other time, because it's a big subject. But in short, if you want to counter the resistance of the mind to change, to newness, to accept new knowledge, you need to become aware of the tendency of the mind to stop. Counter the changes, take the influences from another. So usually the another is a teacher, and the resistance is towards the teachings. So there's only one way to identify these tendencies. Let them continue when your physical existence is under threat. But if the ignorance is under threat, you surrender them. You don't act on them. How to do that? First, you need to become aware that when they fire up, when these processes fire up, and what kind of actions they produce. So, yes, mind is an instrument. Mind is the holder of knowledge, and mind is the holder of the ignorance also. So, actually, I'm jumping ahead of everything. So, it not only, you know, produces ignorance through all these actions, it has the capability to remove the ignorance also. So the use of the instrument, you know, it is a two-edged sword, kind of. You can either use it for the benefit of the mind, for improvement of the mind, or you can use it to just, you know, dwell in the ignorance. Mother Nature does not distinguish between the two kinds. It allows everything, you know. The universe allows every kind of mind there is, because that is what... So yes, the self-preserving tendencies are just one kind of processes that are going on in the mind. I'm going to share with you a picture that I made, a diagram of the mind, and it will give you a very, you know, very, very rough overview of how the mind looks, at least how this human mind looks, you know, because we cannot go and look into other kinds of minds, but they are mostly similar. They are going, all the minds are going to have, you know, one or the other of this process, probably more. The more evolved and more, you know, bigger minds have more processes going on, more refined and more complicated. But this is going to be the basic structure of all the minds. Everything is like this. And the memory is the center point. Now, it is not like there is a space in the mind and memory is placed in the center and other processes are, you know, around it in space. No, it is not like that. Mind is non-physical, has no space. It does not even have time. So, processes are happening. They are changes. Changes are virtual. Process patterns and processes are metaphysical. And memory is the essence of it, not the center of it. But because we need to convey somehow, the drawing is made like this. And there is a second drawing, which is, you know, drawn in another way, so that it suggests that the memory is the base of all the minds and everything is happening based upon a memory. So our usual you know, everyday view of the memory is, let us go into, you know, the memory a little bit. Let us study it a little bit, although it is a very huge subject. So our daily impression, you know, day-to-day impression of the memory is that it is the ability to store some numbers, names, and, you know, and then recall them. And you remember some things, you remember some events more, you remember the movies and songs, and you forget the other things. And it is something in the mind, you know, which keeps the things in it. Like, you know some people and you remember their faces. That is what the memory is. But the spiritual view, the broader view, the greater view of the memory is something different. Memory is just a structure, and it contains all the impressions that it has ever, you know, come across. It has ever experienced. And now you can see the experience in the light of the memory. You see, without memories, there is something, there is experiencing, a very, very pure kind of experiencing with memory. It is converted into something else, which we call as the human experience. A mind is born, and, you know, the mind can check different parts of the memory and, you know, can create the divisions now. And when it, you know, takes a look back, it finds the experiencer behind everything. And this is how the division is born. When the mind takes a look at itself, oh, there is an experience. When it, you know, dissolves back a little bit, you know, steps back a little bit, it says there is an experiencer also. So, and, you know, the whatever that is, you know, which I am also calling as presence, creates a divide in itself just to experience itself. This is a play that is going on. And this play takes many, many forms. Many, many patterns. Some of the patterns, they organize. Some of the pattern have a memory-like capabilities. And some of the memories, they organize these processes around them and become functional minds. So every pattern has a little bit of memory. You know, it gets influenced by other patterns a little bit. Every pattern has this ability of memory. But there are some specific, special patterns that, you know, get evolved as they grow, as the memory accumulates and the, you know, natural processes keep it going, they evolve into something big, and we call them as living beings. They are living minds, they are active minds. They're not simply, you know, take on impressions and gone. It's not like this. So we humans are one such form. We are living beings, we are living minds. We have a date of birth and we have expiry date. All the minds have expiry date. Because why? Because they are experiences. They are impermanent. But our minds, they last for a long time actually. Now, the amazing thing is, if you see the drawing, body is shown in a corner with the senses. Which is, you know, if you take a look at this drawing, it looks like a very tiny part of the mind. Which it is actually. A body is a temporary part of the mind which comes and goes. It is a disposable part of the mind, you know. The mind keeps it as long as it needs it, and then it dissolves back into the basic components. Does not get organized. And now this is a big subject. Why is there a need of body, and why do we need it? And the function of the body is that body is an interface with the physical world. That's why it is part physical, part mental. It's an interface. It acts in both directions. This is what we mean by the interface. So the mind acts in the physical world using a body. It cannot act directly in, you know, that kind of... what is physical world? Physical world is also a collection of patterns, but more inert, more organized means more limited, more structured, obeys very, very strict laws, rigid laws. Yes, the body is also called an avatar, and you cannot take it with you. The mind cannot keep it. It is a fundamental limitation. You know, the body has... body is a temporary structure that is attached to the mind if there is a need. What is the need in case of humans? The need is a desire to have the experiences of the world. Desire is the cause of birth of a body. Now, again, long, big subject. We are on the topic of origin of the mind. But, you know, mind is a very interesting thing actually. Why? Because there is nothing else there except the mind. That is the only thing that exists. So obviously it is going to be the most interesting thing. Everything is produced by the mind. When it interacts with those so-called physical patterns using a body and senses, it produces the whole physical world. The whole physical universe is being produced by a mind actually. It is a tiny part of the universal mind, and human mind is a tiny part of that mind. How do I know all these things actually? I can show you that the physical world is a part of the mind. A physical world and this mind are the same thing, you know. They are a continuous whole. We divide it, the mind, you know, our ignorance divides it into many, many parts. And once it is shown, then, you know, the next step is easy, because then all the minds are now a part of the whole. All the minds are connected and all the worlds are connected. They are part of the whole. And so, you know, very easy to know that this is all just part of one whole thing, where the sea, it is a sea of patterns, and we are just one bubble in that sea actually. One tiny bubble which lasts for like an eye blink for the sea. From the point of view of the sea, our minds, human minds, although they last for, you know, thousands and thousands of years, they are just a bubble. Like, the existence is momentary for humans. And this is the bad news. The good news is that, you know, there is evolution going on, evolution of the minds, and it will not last, but it will change into something better. Now, some minds will be lost, you know. We cannot actually very confidently say that all minds are going to become something else. Some get you know, recycled actually. Nothing is lost in this whole creation. Everything gets used by somehow. So even if some mind, you know, fails, something goes wrong, it gets recycled. So let's go back to the pattern. Now, what happens to the pattern when the body is gone? Obviously, nothing happens. Nothing can happen. Body is an attachment to the mind. Disappearance of the body does nothing to the mind. Now, how do I know this? I cannot explain it actually. You need to find it out for yourself. How will you do that? This is where, you know, the essence of the teaching comes in, how to find it out. There are many, many ways actually. Yeah. Depending on the tradition you're following, depending on your teachers, your guru, your conditioning, upbringing, and your interest and curiosity, your tendency, you will find many methods to get there. Now, I leave it to you to search, you know, explore, because you are the seeker. And when you seek, you will find the answers. I can simply, you know, tell you to believe me, but then you will know nothing because it won't be your experience. Your experience is your knowledge. The experience gets imprinted on the memory and it forms a knowledge. So what is knowledge? Knowledge is also memory. It is in the mind. So this was a, you know, very short introduction to what is mind according to the big picture. Now, we have actually finished the basics. The universal mind, I consider it as not basic actually. I cannot give you any experience of the universal mind. I can give you, I can show you the mind, the human mind, the world, the processes that are going on in the mind, you know. If you sit down and, you know, introspect, introspection is one of the way to know the mind. You take this diagram, take this drawing, you know, save it, study it, try to confirm it with your own experience. Is there anything wrong there? You know, is there anything that doesn't make sense? Is there some process which does not involve memory in any form? Or is there any memory which is operating without processes? Find out, because you can experience it. And this is one way to gain knowledge by direct observation. And there is a shortcut to gain knowledge, you know. The shortcut is your teacher. You listen to the teacher. Because teacher is coming from somewhere, you know. Teacher has done all the hard work for you. And then you listen to the teacher. Don't believe a single word. But listen carefully and experiment on yourself. Find out the results of that experiment. Whether teacher was right, wrong. Whether he was just, you know, giving you theories. Or whether there is some solid truth in there. So what I was saying is, we have come to the basics, end of the basics here. When you know what is mind, actually nothing much remains to be known. It is an experience, that's all it is. And the universal mind, you know, becomes a part of the advanced teaching, where you need to actively explore. You'll need to make efforts to know the universal mind. Why? Because our mind, because of the self-preservation tendencies, has, you know, erected walls around it. It does not let the bigger experiences to come in right now. And it takes a little bit of effort to get past that. And then again, there are methods to go there. You can have all those experiences if you want. Or you can, you know, conclude from the ordinary experiences, the experiences of the day-to-day life will provide you exactly the same knowledge which the extraordinary experiences provide. So, once you study it like this, you know, the possibilities start broadening, becomes bigger and bigger. You will never see the mind, you know, as a temporary process that happens with the body and gone with the body. There you will see it as something much bigger, you know, much more universal in quality. And temporary, but longer lasting than our limited experiences. The possibility opens up, our minds open up when we study our own mind. And if you go on study, if you go on, you know, in depth into the mind, who knows, you will find all the evidences that you wanted. You will find them. Whenever I study my mind, I always find something, you know, fascinating there. So go and study the mind. And in the advanced, you know, when I'm going to repeat all the advanced stuff again, we'll take up the universal mind again and we'll discuss how to gain that experiences of the universal mind. But in the next meeting, I'm going to give you something more fundamental, something even more fundamental, which is how to gain knowledge itself, how to use mind to gain knowledge. you know. Now you know what is the mind, where it is, you know, where is the knowledge, how it holds the knowledge, what, you know, what is really happening there. And in, you can, you know, think about it. And next Sunday there will be a new topic, but next Wednesday there will be a repeat topic, and I'm going to take up the topic of what is knowledge, what is path of knowledge, what kinds of knowledge are there, what is truth, what is not, you know, not true, and how to know whether something is true or not. And we'll go into all these things. So yes, mind is very complicated, and so it can be very, very tricky. So it is worthwhile to learn the techniques to gain knowledge. If you don't have the techniques, if you don't have the skills, you will, you know, be tricked by the mind very easily. You will remain in ignorance forever, till the whole life of the mind, you know, however millions of years it is, who cares? So any questions on this topic of the origin of the mind? Yes, if you want to study the mind, then there is no point in, you know, getting involved in the drama of the mind. You need to separate a little, you know, higher part of your mind. You need to separate it out and simply watch the rest of it from that point of view. So you'll find that just like everything else, just like every other experiences, the experiences in the mind, the events in the mind, they are also impermanent. They don't last, you know, very, very fragile. They come and go very fast. It is very, very fluid. That is just habit. It is the mind falling back into its attachment with the events in the mind and with itself, and then the mind comes out. When it gets tired of it, it comes out and simply sees what is going on. Sometimes one part of the mind will, you know, intervene and stop the other part. Usually it happens with the ego. Sometimes the ego comes and, you know, totally obliterates the higher mind. Your intelligence will be wiped out. Sometimes the higher mind comes and, you know, wipes out the ego. It is very interesting to watch all this happening in the mind. Yes, so this is what we call as cultivation. More you become aware of what is happening in the mind, it gets cultivated. It becomes a little bit more organized and disciplined than it was before. So active cultivation starts with a teaching. It starts with a teacher. A teacher will plant a seed in your mind that, why don't you do this? And, you know, in some of, not all the students, some of the students, this instantly, you know, manifests. This idea, you know, takes root and turns into action. We think that it is being done by the person, but, you know, personality is just another process in the mind, you know. We have seen that the personality or the identity or the doer is just one more process. There is no such thing as the doer. It just happens. So, your progress starts as soon as you come across a teaching. The source of the teaching is a teacher. When you seek actively, you seek out the sources. That means you seek out the teachers, you seek out the teachings. This is why we call ourselves as seekers. We just don't sit and watch. We proactively go and, you know, destroy the ignorance. You will learn a lot simply by being alive. But life of a seeker is more active. He is totally, or he or she is totally inactive in the worldly matters, you see. Does not do, you know, does not look like they are doing anything at all, you know. But they are very, very busy inside. They are actively studying the mind, actively changing it, taking it towards some place where the natural flow of things is already taking it. So anyway, that is the process of seeking and spiritual evolution. So spiritual evolution is just the evolution of the mind. Not of the spirit. Spirit does not need to evolve. It is already perfect. It is all there is. So it is already perfect. So anyway, thank you for attending today's meeting. And there are net problems, there will be net problems, and we are going to repeat it again, so no issues. And I'll see you again in the next meeting on Sunday. Thank you very much for joining today.
Pure Experiences.
You are listening to Pure Experiences by Tharun Pradhan. For more, please visit pureexperiences.blogspot.in.